how is Rabobank approaching that? Obviously, some employees are going to leave anyway. That always happens. But are you providing them an alternative that, hey, you're really strong with this idea, it looks good, we'll help you launch it, but you kind of stay under the Rabobank umbrella or Rabobank invests in you? Do you have any processes there?
Well, we are trying to get that more and more in place. So we have these kind of venture capital kind of processes for external startups. But more and more we are seeing, okay, maybe we should apply that also to these internal startups. So we don't have them yet, but by organizing more and more hackathons and to have more little startup, well, I don't know if they're companies or startup teams based on these hackathons, and they are, and what you see is that they are really passionate about the service or the product they have developed. But at the moment, we don't have the procedures and we don't have the funds to support them. But we are working on that as an innovation team to help that and to have a better internal accelerator also for those stages. And what I now also see is that sometimes I have one example of an employee who did go outside the company, did a startup, but then found out, okay, I really want to do this more in a larger company. So he's back at the Rabobank, and he now is a really great ambassador and mentor internally for these internal startups. Yeah,
he can be your change agent for entrepreneurship.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, because I think this is the next step, is how do we get employees to launch startups within the organization? And this is very much the angle that the Academy for Corporate Entrepreneurship is taking, as well as being allowed to collaborate with external startups, especially in the beginning stages.
Yeah, and I think it's also, if I'm looking at the way our IT department is now developing, one of the higher executives within the IT department say, okay, we have to look more at Spotify squads, for example, and where you see, okay, you have an internal team within Spotify who is responsible for a part of the service, the end service to the customer, and to have more DevOps teams, development and operations combined. So you can say, okay, we are going to do an umbrella of these new startups, but also the way you are organizing your own organization by having more multidisciplinary teams who have more own responsibility. It almost seems that they are little startups within the company. So that's also how you organize it. And we traditionally did within IT a very hierarchically organized top-down way of organizing. And I guess the next 1.5 years. We are transforming more and more into this IT organization where you have smaller teams who know more exactly what they are doing for the end customer. I always really like the example of the person who's cleaning the floor at NASA, the aerospace, and when they ask him, okay, what are you doing here? He said, I'm helping people to the moon. And I think that's being an entrepreneur and being a startup is helping deliver services which helps your customers. And if we can provide that connection between people who are down in the IT cellars of our company and to give them the feeling and to show them what they are, how they are helping the end customers, that also stimulates the entrepreneurial minds, I guess.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, an organization only exists to serve its customers, right?
Absolutely right. Totally agree. Yeah.
Employees, wherever they are, if they understand this, it's intrinsically going to help with their motivation. That's why they come to work.
Yeah.
Okay. It sounds like there's a lot of different innovation startup activities going on. There must be some decent-sized budgets behind all of this, Martin. What were some of the challenges in getting these processes up and running? Were you blocked very often by management, or was it easy to convince them?
Well, we are lucky that we have a very innovative CIO. So he's very stimulating innovation, and he sees the money he's investing in our team, which we have 7 people in our innovation team within IT. That he says, okay, this is for experimental reasons, but we have some targets, like 2/3 of our innovation projects. We do a lot of proof of concepts each year, and 2/3 of them, within an average of 2 to 3 years, must be applicable in a new service or product of the Rabobank. So we are not doing really the hardcore experimental innovation, but more the applied kind of innovation. We are now starting, with the help of this CIO, also developing more business model innovation teams. But I guess the biggest hinder and the biggest block of innovation is the implementation of innovation. So it's relatively easy to start an innovation, to start a proof of concept, or to do a hackathon, and even to join accelerator programs. But the proof of the pudding is in the eating, and to implement and to make innovation as part of every part of the organization. And that we are not there yet, and that's difficult, because within a bank you have an organization and a mentality of avoiding risks. Because what you want that people can take money out of the ATM machine, can do money transfers online, use their mobile app. So you don't want any disturbances there. So people are focused on not to change very much, because that can compromise the services to our customers. And within that kind of culture, you have to say, okay, how can we improve that? So how we do that within our organization is say, okay, let's, if you look at innovation, let's take 70% on innovating and incrementally. So trying to help existing processes and existing services to innovate. Then let's use 20% on more business model innovation and more kind of radical innovation. And 10% to say, okay, really go beyond the line and say, okay, what if there was no bank, or what if we cannot do financing? What can we do then? So by giving the organization, say, okay, these are the ways we divide our budget and our attention to, really, I guess, really helped us also by saying, okay, we are helping also your department with innovation.
Mm. I really like that split, 70-20-10. I think that's actually in line with what Google are doing as well with their innovation budgets.
Okay.
Yeah, I heard that the other week. But let's zoom in on that, because one question I did want to ask you, we're talking a lot about innovation, right?
Yeah.
And I think I want to move it a little bit to entrepreneurial spirit.
Yep.
Where do you see the entrepreneurial spirit fitting in or being a necessity, and how are Rabobank's employees able to benefit from that in order to help you with this 70-20-10 approach?
Yeah, I think one of the things which helped us a lot was introducing this new way of working. We started that in 1996. Wait, that was in Interpos. We started that within Rabobank in 2006. And this new way of working program really did give, we focus on less rules, less internal rules, that people could work any place, any time, that the buildings of the Rabobank were more like a meeting place for people. We want to give people more responsibility so that they could take more ownership of things. So that's, I think, one of the basics for this entrepreneurial stuff.
How just quickly on that point, how did that get introduced? Was that a new rule set by the CEO?
Well, it did help that the executive board did encourage it. But it wasn't implemented from a top-down perspective. We were seducing actually departments to use this new way of working. So each you couldn't do it individually. So if you wanted to move over to this new way of working, then you had to do it with a complete team or a complete department. I think eventually, because we are still, because we started in 2006, we are still in the process. There are still teams and departments who really don't want to work in this this way. But by saying, okay, you don't have to do it, but we give you all the instruments to work in this new way. I think now almost 90% of our companies is working that way because they see the benefits of it. There are some things you have to solve, for example, by giving people the possibility to work any place, anytime. We found out that agile teams and scrum teams they were a little bit lost because they really need and also the startup teams to be closely together, physically close together, and you can of course use Google Hangouts and link and communicate a kind of stuff, but to be physically in the in each other's neighborhood is very important. So we did fine tune the concept a little bit there to provide those kind of areas. Mm. And also, I guess being a cooperative bank, we have the DNA of being entrepreneurial. So each of our local branch, they have ownership of their local bank, and actually there are like 200. Small banks in the Netherlands, Rabobanks, and they are ownership of their own market. That's also tricky because since the banking crisis in the Netherlands, our regulators say, okay, stop the entrepreneurship. You have to follow these and these rules, and these rules are getting stricter and more strict each year. That's a difficult thing to do. But then again, if you look at Silicon Valley and you see these 3,000 fintech startups, they can do it also. Sometimes the regulators don't apply to them, but we have to learn from that and to keep this entrepreneurial spirit alive. Yeah.
Okay, great. So let's tie it back to something we mentioned at the beginning, this 23% of current revenue being under threat. Mm-hmm. You identified that a few years back. Have you seen any concrete ROI as a result of the new innovation methods and allowing people to be entrepreneurial that you'd be able to talk about?
Of course. What we saw, for example, in changing the services to internet, when we start internet banking, but that was even before that, mobile banking nowadays. So we see a shift of our customers moving from the physical branches to the digital services. That's of course helping in cost efficiency. It's also a threat to employees because they see like, okay, yeah, my job is at stake here. So that's also a difficult balance. If you say, okay, yeah, this is the future and it's nice, all new technology and everything is going to be better for our customers, but people, our employees are saying, okay, yeah, but what about me and what about my job? Because that's also changing, because that's what we are saying. Okay, you don't need to do the more traditional and the boring stuff, but you can do the more complex advisory stuff now, and that's also helpful. I think we are still at the really early stage, because what we are doing now is taking our current processes and trying to do that more in a virtual way. So that's I once heard about horseless carriages. The first automobiles were like a horseless carriage in that same shape. So I think we are in that stage. What the next step will be is, okay, how can we use this new technology for a new kind of business model? And we are not there yet. We are experimenting, for example, with a service where we have virtual currencies in a platform where people can help each other. So we have in the Netherlands a local care system where I can help my family member or people in my street. And we provide a platform where you can say, okay, I need help, and people can say, okay, I want to help, and then we apply a currency system for that, like credit systems to help them. So these are things which aren't really the traditional way of doing. So it's getting there, but yeah, I think that will have to be more and more the coming years. If the our revenues are really declining, then we have to have more of these kind of initiatives.
Okay, but for now you're seeing a bigger shift to digital services, which is obviously keeping your customers there, right, and continuing revenues with them.
Yeah.
I had to ask the ROI question just because there's so many managers that are going to look at this, and this is what they think about.
I think the other, it's what you also see, and managers really, I really like the, for example, when we did our second hackathon, there were a lot of presentations of these employees for the managers, and these managers were really surprised of the outcome of these teams, what they achieved in just 2 days, and they were asking, okay, but why can't you do that in your regular job? And they say, oh, we are not allowed to do it. So we are looking at our employees as job descriptions. And I think that's really, really bad. Because and I hope, I think that within, at least within the IT department where I work, that the role of the manager is made way too important in our company. And everybody wanted to be a manager, and yeah, the fast car and a nice suit, etc. But what managers only need to do is facilitate the professionals and to facilitate the entrepreneurs. And that's I really see that shift happening now, and it's a big thing. It's a big thing for managers. It's also a big thing for the company, where if you look at most of our training programs are focusing on management development and management trainings and management courses. And now we are like 2 years now. 2 years ago, we started more professional trainings and to develop more to say to people, okay, what is really your passion? What is your expertise? And let's see how we can develop that more and stimulate that. And to look not as people as a job description, but to see, okay, the whole package and I think that change ultimately we'll see also to the executive that there is an ROI and that you have a huge potential of within your company of people and resources.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point. Actually, I have the belief that entrepreneurial training will actually become compulsory for many people in many different diverse positions across the organization.
Yeah.
And I just wonder how many years away we are from that and what type of companies will be adopting that mm-hmm. first. But that's, I think, how you're going to drive change. And then the returns on that can be in 100 different ways, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, great.
Okay. I think lots of really great advice here so far, and it gives everyone a very deep insight into the activities of Rabobank. Martin, what would be your advice to people out there that are maybe don't have so many processes yet up and running? What advice can you give to help them get started?
Well, just do it, I think. Just start. I had the... for me, it's in my role, but what I see happening to people in also in other companies, but also within our company, that we think that we are hindered and there are all barriers, but the most of these hindrances and barriers are internal barriers. And if you feel something isn't working, or if you think you have to do it another way, try it and do it. Most of the time, it really will work, and you can go move further. And if it doesn't work, ask for forgiveness afterward. Because if you ask for permission on forehand, you won't get it. So I think that's the only advice would really help me doing stuff within our bank. And till now, I'm still still there. And I think if the company says, okay, you did that, and we don't agree, and you're fired, then also you have to think, okay, is this really the company which I want to work for? Is this the place where my skills are suited the best for? So I guess that's what works for me.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think that's a point that Pinchot made in his earlier book, right? You have to go into work every day being prepared to get fired.
Yeah.
And you have to break the rules a little bit, be a little bit of a rebel.
Yeah.
But I think it is changing, because that's a little bit the old model that everything had to happen under the radar. I think now a big part of this is figuring out how to bring in key stakeholders, so that it's not that you're breaking the rules all the time, but you're being allowed to do these things. And I think that the dilemma of management is to figure out how to create this ecosystem and environment to foster this type of behavior.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I think initiatives as your institute and the academy, that really helps. And also, yeah, so it also helps, I guess, it's a new generation of managers and executives. Because we did use Accenture and McKinsey to convince the executive board. But I hope within the coming years that these kind of consultancy organizations won't be necessary to do this kind of stuff. And I see the first signs that's happening already.
Yeah, that's great. Well, these consultancies are coming under a lot of pressure these days as well, but that's a whole nother story.
Right, yeah.
Okay, Martin, thank you very much for joining us today, and wish you all the best with the future innovation projects, and thank you so much for the insights.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here. Thank you.